Okay, so then, now that we established the basic notion of a discrete time system, which is just a function that acts on sequences, so we established that this is something like this. We would like to introduce at least two or three properties of specific. So we established that there are discrete time systems, which are functions that map sequences to sequences, and now we want to look at specific discrete time systems, namely linear time invariant systems. So there can be many discrete time systems, so many functions, and now we're looking at a specific subset of these systems, namely linear time invariant systems. And of course, the reason why we're looking at those is because you remember that Bold fMRI is assumed to be roughly a linear time invariant system. Yeah? So we want to basically establish what this means. So linear time invariant systems are linear and they are time invariant. So let's first look at what a linear system is. Linear systems are defined to be linear functions, so because systems are just functions, the definition of a linear system and a linear function is identical, and a function is defined to be linear if it's additive and homogeneous, which means the following. So additive means that the output of the system to the sum of two inputs, here x plus y, is the sum of the output to each individual input. That is what's known as additivity. And the output to a scalar multiple of an input is the scalar multiple of the response to the input, and that's known as homogeneity. And yeah, this is just what a linear system or linear function is. So yeah, if the sums of two inputs after transformation are the same as the sum of the transformation of each input, or if the scalar multiple of an input is the same as the scalar multiple of the transformation of that input, then a system is said to be linear. One can quite easily show that there's actually a proof of that in the script, that linear systems conform to what is known as the superposition principle, which sometimes is also used as a definition of linearity, but here we view it as a consequence of linearity. So if you scalar multiply one input, add to it the scalar multiple, so b is also a scalar here, of another input, then the response of linear system is the scalar multiple of the response to the first input plus the scalar multiple of the response or the transformation of the second input. No, so there's a very small proof of that in the script. I mean, it looks fairly similar to the linear system's definition already, so I think it's fairly clear. In the script, you can also find a proof of the linearity of accumulator systems. So, to familiarize yourself with this definition of a, can you? It's quite loud. Maybe have breakfast at home. So the superposition principle is basically a very simple consequence of the linear system, sorry, and the linearity of the accumulator system is proven in the script. So maybe you look into the script there to become a little bit more familiar with the definition of linear systems and how these definitions are used then to show that specific systems are linear. What I want to focus a little bit more on now is the notion of time invariance, because that's usually, well, that's the strange thing with time invariance is that it's intuitively quite simple, but with the notation always a little bit confusing. So are there questions about linear systems right now? No? Good, then let's talk about what a time invariant system is. And the basic notion of a time invariant system is that it does not matter when the input occurs, the output to that input is the same but shifted in time. So it just means that the system is time invariant, meaning that it responds the same way to a specific input sequence regardless of when that input occurs. Yeah. So for example, so let's make a drawing first. For example, if you have this input sequence here and zeros everywhere else, and this is happening here at 1, 2, 3. And let's say the output, so that's our x, and the output tx is 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. The output is, now I'm just making something up without being able to specify how that looks as a function. Let's say the output is, it's always zero, and then it's something like this. That's the output here. So this is mapped onto that. Now this input sequence, of course, had this value 1, 2, 3, had the values 1, 2, and 3 at the times 1, 2, 3. Now we could think about shifting this sequence, the input sequence in time. So, for example, to present this sequence of maybe let's take the 0 in, so 0, 1, 2, 3, not at times 0, 1, 2, 3, but for example at times 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, and there's zeros before that and zeros after that. If the output to that is then also shifted in the same way, so that at 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, the output is actually all zeros. And then at times 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, you again get the output that you got if the input would have occurred at 0, 1, 2, 3, then the system is said to be time invariant. Yeah? So it's intuitively, it's very simple. It just means that regardless of when the input occurs, so what these indices are, the output is the same but shifted in time. Which of course is something, if you have this as a biological system, then if you do the experiment now and you give some stimulus and observe the response, or whether you do that in a minute from now, you get the same response. And you already know that this is not quite true for both responses, because there's adaptation. So if you give a stimulus now and the same stimulus briefly after that, you don't get quite the same response. But in general, if you separate stimuli or events by 5 to 8 seconds, then you get roughly the same response. So that's the notion of time invariance. From an intuitive perspective, and I'll try to write that up again. So a system t from the infinite sequences to the infinite sequences is time invariant, so that's just the system. Is time invariant. If for, and then one needs to look a little bit careful at the notation. So these are just these are just some input and outputs. If and then we need to introduce a shifted sequence so that we can write as then it holds Yeah, so these are the, so the X and the Y, these are the input and output in the non-shifted manner. Then we consider the shifted, the time shifted input and shifted by J indices. So if you want the ith element of x tilde, you take the x ith minus jth element. Yeah? And if then the output you can also get from taking the I minus jth element of the output sequence, then the system is time invariant. Yeah, how are we doing with the time? Yeah. Let's briefly look at that notation business. So let's again, I always do dots there when I do indices. So let's say 0, 1, 2, 3. And let's look at our accumulator system for inputs 1, 2, 1 and zeros everywhere else. So that would be our x. And then let's look at the accumulator output. That would be y, and that at 0, 1, 2, 3, and the output, make this red, would be 0, 1, and then 1 plus 2, so 3, 1, 2, 3, 4, so that would be 1, and then we have to add 2, so we get to 3, and then we have to add 1 again, so we get to 4, and afterwards we remain at 4. So that would be the accumulator output to this input sequence, and now we want to shift x by, let's say, 3. So let's say our j is 3, Let's take a little bit more. 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. And this is now our x tilde, where x tilde I is given by xi minus j. Oops, xi minus j. Or xi minus 3 better. So at 0 we have 0 minus 3, so minus what we here had at minus 3, and that was 0, so it remains 0. So at 0 here we get we need to look here. So that's our I here, and that's our I minus j. Now at I minus, so if we go here, then at here before we had all zeros. Let's make them blue here. We had all zeros, which are not shown on the left. But then at 1, we had 1, so we are now here. That's this, if you have a minus, you shift to the right, which is always confusing, but that's how it is. And if we are at 5, we have to look at 2 here, so we have a 2 here. And if we are at 6, we are at 3 here, so we have a 1 here. And if we are at 7, we have a 4, we are at 4, and we have zeros here. Yeah. So this is just shifting the input x to x tilde based on this definition. Yeah. And then what time invariance means is that we can evaluate the response to the shifted sequence by looking at the unshifted output sequence and shifting it the same way. So again, at before we again need to respect our shift here. Just writing these shifted indices down again, minus 2, minus 1, 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. And then this was 0 all along. And for this I minus j, it's still 0. And then we have 1. Then at 5, then we have 1. Then we have 3. It's a little bit shifted with respect to this, sorry. Then we have 3, and at 6 we have 4, and then it remains like this. And this, if this actually holds for the accumulator system, which it does, which is proven also in the script, then we say it's time invariant. So again, the notion of time invariance intuitively is quite simple. It just means when it doesn't matter when you give the input sequence, the response is the same. It's only shifted in time. This is very natural. So you give an input sequence now, you wait a minute. So you observe the output, you wait a minute, you give it the same input sequence, you get the same output response. It's a little bit annoying with these indexing business. But yeah, so don't get confused. If you feel confused, always think back of the intuition, what it means, and that's clear. And then yeah, find a way to be happy with the index writing. Good, that's time invariant systems. Good. Then we are now ready to actually talk about convolution. Because convolution only applies in the context of linear time invariant system. So we could not create our MRI regressors using convolution if we wouldn't believe that the Bode system or the fMRI Bode system is a linear time invariant system or can be modeled as a linear time invariant system. So this assumption is basically built into doing this convolution. And then the then the nice thing is that we can actually we don't need to evaluate for every specific sequence the output sequence to characterize this system, but we only need to evaluate the impulse response function to characterize the system and then compute all other sequences. So let's make this more concrete, what I want to say here. The first thing that we need is the impulse response function. That's very important. So the impulse response function, which we denote by HK, that's an H here. And the reason why we use an H is because this will be our hemodynamic response function. The HK, which is a sequence, this is defined for system T is defined as the response to the unit sample sequence K. Yeah. So now we are just talking about putting in a specific form of sequences into a system, namely our unit sample sequences, and in this case K. And we characterize and we measure and we define whatever you want what the response to such a unit sample sequence is. Yeah? So unsurprisingly, to make this already, to connect this with your intuition about fMRI, if we assume we give a unit sample sequence at zero, then for the fMRI Bode system, then of course we have in mind that the here I need to make this careful. So this is of course the response. This is the delta zero. So it has a 1 at 0 and 0s everywhere else. And then if we give something like that to the hemodynamic, if we give something like this to the fMRI Bode system, then we get something like this. So we have a pre-stimulus undershoot. Then we have an increase here. And then it goes back to baseline. So based on the idea that if we give a visual stimulus here, this is our visual stimulus at time zero, then we observe in the MR signal this typical up and down of a hemodynamic response. Yeah? And this observation, so you give this and you observe this, so that's T delta zero. This is now formalized in this idea of an impulse response function. where you can essentially give this impulse response function at any time point, and you observe the output then in response to that. It doesn't say yet that the system is time invariant, which you might already have in your head, that if you give this stimulus at a later time, that then also the hemodynamic response function is shifted, which is called fairly natural, because that's how it is. But right now we are just saying the kth impulse response function is defined as the response of the system to the kth unit sample sequence. Yeah? Because we can have either in time invariant system or not. But we need this impulse response function. Yeah, questions about impulse response function for a system right now?
So why we are just accepting that this port signal is time invariant in this context? I don't understand this.
Well, I mean, this is the like the discussion that we had in neurocognitive methods. So it's time invariant if we separate the stimuli by a given amount of time. So if we separate them by 5 seconds or so, then the responses to the same stimulations are essentially the same responses, but shifted in time. And if we go to closer or to shorter interstimulus intervals, then of course we get more of an error because we get adaptation effects. But of course, using convolution is very, using linear time invariant systems is very convenient because it's simple and you don't need to account for this nonlinear adaptation effects. And hence, it's generally appreciated that if you separate your trials, your events, your stimuli by some degree in time, then you can use this convolution approach, because that's what the experimental results also show. Yeah. We are not quite there yet, because now we can state the convolution theorem, which is actually quite important. So the convolution theorem then says the following. So we assume that we have a system. And this system is linear and time invariant. Let it be a linear time invariant system. Then the elements samples yi of the output for an arbitrary input x and we use that doesn't really matter, can either call this xi, we can also call the running variable k here already, because it will be k in the definition. We can also just say nothing, that's maybe easiest. So the elements yi for an arbitrary input x, so a sequence x, can be written as yi minus infinity to plus infinity xk h 0 I minus k. And here is the I minus k element of obviously the impulse response function to the unit sample sequence at time zero. Now, this is really helpful because it allows us to compute the output of a system to any input by just knowing the input, of course, and the response, the impulse response function. Yeah. So if you know the impulse response function, then you can compute the output of a linear time invariant system for any input, meaning that you can make a prediction about the MR signal for any kind of input sequence of events. Of course, you can sometimes you have experiments where you have a stimulus every 20 seconds, sometimes this is more random and so on. So all of these possibilities, you can compute the output of the Bolt system by considering your input and the form of the impulse response function. Yeah, and it's exactly this formula here, although of course then for finite sequences, which is discussed also in the script, that is used in the code to generate the design matrix columns. Yeah, and that's convolution. That's the convolution theorem. So let's look at why this holds first. So let's look at a proof, because in the proof it becomes apparent that this is really linked to this assumption of linear and time invariant systems. So the first thing that we need to appreciate again is that we can write any function or represent, oh sorry, that we can write any sequence or represent it as the sum of unit sample responses. So this is something that we've seen previously. And then we can think that, okay, if we have the output y as the transform or the output of the system to this input, this is the same as, because we can write any input sequence as above, we can, this is the same as this. And then we assume linearity, because we are dealing with linear time invariant systems. So to get from here to here, we need linearity, because under linearity we can then essentially get the transform under the sum sign. So this is allowed because of the linearity. And then with the definition of the kth hemodynamic, with the kth impulse response function, this is just this. So to get this far into the proof, we definitely need the system to be a linear system, because otherwise this would not hold. And then what we do is we also capitalize on the time invariance. And in this regard, we first consider H0, so the impulse response function to the unit sample sequence with the one at time zero. and to evaluate, so just writing a little bit here, to evaluate hik, so talking about the ith element of the kth impulse response function, we use the shifted version of I minus k. So we're using this thing that we only that the response is always the same. We just need to shift it in time, and then we can continue writing for the elements of this. So yi is the ith element of this long thing here. Oh, not long, but this thing. The ith element of this. Is of course xk times hik. Well, of course, all of these hik are always zero except for the one at k, but then we can replace hik with our shifted response to the time at to the input at zero. So we get the yith element by this, and but we only get it if we assume that t is linear and that time invariance holds for t. Yeah. So this idea that we model the Bolt fMRI system by a linear time invariant system is deeply ingrained and embedded in this convolution that is done every day, 1,000 times in all the fMRI labs in the world, where people click in SPM, create design, or in some other software, and this convolution is evaluated. This always means that people assume that modeling the stimulus, neural response, hemodynamic response, MR signal system is a linear time invariant system. Yeah? And this whole exercise on this whole discussion today was about to say that this linear time invariant system view of Bolt is crucial for making convolution an operation that actually makes sense. Now in the script there's a little bit more on convolution, so I really recommend that you look at that. One thing is that if we're dealing with finite sequences, we can actually use this, and then look at sequences where everything is zero except outside a window, and then we actually find that we can also write the convolution sum as this, where we now shift actually the input arguments. Sequences. So this basically, and this is why I'm not going into much detail about this, this is just a consequence of this. So the hard thing to establish is this. Once you establish this, to see that for finite sequences you can get to this, that's fairly straightforward. So that's this proof of 831 of finite impulse response function convolution in the script, because our impulse response functions that we have in fMRI, of course, finite, and also our input sequences are finite. So finite always means only non-zero for a set of n indices. And then once this is established, one can actually code this up, and you can of course also look into the MATLAB code that comes with the script PMFN, and then based on that there is an example that shows the following. So this would be the delta 0, so the unit sample sequence 0, where the 1 is at 0 and it's everywhere else 0. Then the impulse response function here to this input of a system is kind of assumed to be of this form. And then what is being used here to compute the response to this input sequence is exactly this equation here. And then if you compute this compute the values of yi based on this equation and based on this impulse response function and this input sequence, you get this, which is of course already fairly close to what you have in mind for a Bolt response regressor. So a little bit of homework is to look into this case of the finite input response function. That's fairly short. It's kind of like half a page in the script. And maybe the last thing to note then today is what is now the canonical hemodynamic response function, because there is one model that is always used as the hemodynamic response function. Which is of course meant to model the hemodynamic response that was observed in the old visual stimulus experiments. And this model, I think, which you also would be required to study a little bit in as a homework, is given by the difference of two gamma functions, gamma density functions, I should say. So this function is allocating to 0, 1, and so on values in the real numbers, and what it gives you are two gamma densities that are subtracted from one another with these parameters. So there's quite a parameter set associated with the canonical hemodynamic response function, and these parameters are fixed. So they are in, for example, SPM, you can look up what these parameters are, and they are not estimated or something from the data. They are just fixed parameters depending also on the support interval, so the question of how TR. And these are gamma probability density functions, and these gamma probability density functions allocate to positive numbers positive values. There's a T missing. T maps to GT alpha beta, and this takes this form. So this is just the function that is used in the hemodynamic response function, and it's used twice. It's once used to create this peak here, so this first gamma function creates the peak, and this creates the stimulus undershoot. And as an example for plotting these function, this is also in the script, of course. these functions then for different parameter settings look like this. So you've seen that there are these theta parameters, and there are 5 of them. And if you set the theta parameters somewhat differently, this double gammas function then looks slightly different. So each parameter has a specific meaning that you can study. And you see that, overall, this hemodynamic response function is comprising these two gammas, one of which is being subtracted from the other, creates these HRF-like or looking or hemodynamic response-like functions. Yeah? And that's the canonical HRF. And these are then used at discrete values to convolve input sequences. Yeah? Good. That would be it. Any questions you have? Again, we remember them and let's discuss them at the beginning of the next session. In the next session, then I assume that you are happy with how the regressors of a design matrix in fMRI are created based on your experimental design. And what we will then look at is how to estimate the associated parameters, so the beta parameters of these regressors, so that we learn about the maximum likelihood estimation of the general linear model. If you don't know what maximum likelihood estimation is, we will briefly talk about that next time, but also I always recommend statistics for data science, where today the topic is also maximum likelihood estimation. Good, then see you later or next week.